small north, roughly half the world's population still lives on the equivalent of less than $2 a day. And in many places, having a job doesn't guarantee escape from the poverty. Now, putting job creation at the heart of economic policy making and development plans will not only generate decent work opportunity, but also more robust increase in poverty reducing growth. It is as good for the economy as it is for the people, and one that drives this sustainable development goal actually drives the growth of the country. So here we are for this webinar today on Sustainable Development Goal 8, Decent Work and Economic Growth. Good morning all, I'm Dr. Shipra Sunpusari, working as a professor in the Department of Obstetrics and Gynecology, coordinator for SDG 8, Decent Work.
Madam, audio is very poor. Can you
moderator for this webinar today on Sustainable Development Goal 8? We have today very knowledgeable and experienced speakers with us. There's so much to learn and hear from them, actually, but we have limited time. So without taking any more time, I invite our beloved, ever motivating, ever encouraging Vice Chancellor, Nitya Deemed University Professor Dr. Satish Kumar Bhandari to open this session with his valuable opening remarks. Over to you, sir.
Good morning. It's my privilege to be part of this webinar series on Sustainable Development Goal. First of all, I'd like to thank the resource person, very distinguished resource persons who have accepted our invitation to participate in this lecture series. Mr. Ramakant Desai, FinTech Forum, Bangalore, and I understand he's a very distinguished resource person. He's a management consultant and a corporate advisor and chairperson of Bangalore FinTech Forum and chairperson of ASSOCHAM Healthcare Initiative, and also in the advisory panel of Karnataka BJP Economic Cell. Thank you, Mr. Ramakant Desai, for accepting the invitation and participating in this webinar. And I also thank another very distinguished participant, Dr. Sandhya, for participating in this webinar series. Thank you, Sandhya, for offering your services, for enlightening our colleagues here. And as you all know, we are very really geared for sustainable development goal adaptation in the university. There is an increasing acceptance of the idea that economic development, social development and environmental protection have to go hand in hand. Sustainable Development Goals, as identified by the United Nations, I understand there are 17 SDGs, and they can have a tremendous impact on the human development. I think this is very, very important. Luckily, we have been enlightened about the Sustainable Development Goals recently, because the awareness has been created about the Sustainable Development Goals. However, achieving this success of these goals requires concerted efforts, not only by the individuals, also by non-governmental agencies, and naturally the government have to play a very big role in achieving these sustainable development goals. As you all know, education is a key factor for achieving sustainable development goals. Without universities, I think we cannot fully achieve the sustainable development goals, and definitely universities can contribute to answer for these SDGs of the societies to education, research through their outreach activities, as well as by forging partnership to promote responsible development. Nitya University is really conscious about its social responsibilities. As you all know, our vision itself says that it's our aim to build a human society through excellence in education, healthcare. Our trust started in the, I think, 42 years back by very distinguished the Supreme Court, the former Supreme Court judge and speaker of Lok Sabha, Justice K.S. Hegde. He started with a small school in his native village. After retirement, he settled down in his village and started a small school. Now it has grown into a large education hub with the three campuses in Bangalore, at Nitte is for the Founders Village, and in Mangalore, where our university is located. And the school which was started with some 80 students, now we have got more than 20,000 students and more than 3,500 staff. This social responsibility resonates in our vision, and social action has been our cornerstone in all our education policies. Now we are working towards integrating our diverse social responsible activities under the framework of sustainable development goal. And we got recognized for our sustainability last year. University participated in the Times Higher Education ranking. And I'm very glad to tell you that in three categories, good health and well-being, gender equity, and clean water and sanitation, we are one among the 200 best university in the world. We are in the 101-200 bracket. And in the overall ranking, we are in the bracket of 400 to 600. It has been very encouraging development. And I think we have to do still more. And by adopting this sustainable development goal into our policies and all our actions of the university, I think we can achieve better in other parameters, other goals also. And with that aim, this year we have started a webinar series on SDGs. All the SDG 17 will be discussed in the university, and it will be addressed by very distinguished speakers, and the responsibilities have been given to various faculty of the university to conduct webinar in all the 17 SDGs of the United Nations. And I understand today's theme, the theme 8, is the decent work and economic growth. We understand that any university cannot be, or any institution for that matter, cannot be built with the bricks and mortars. What is important is the human resources and the skilled human resource. That is very, very important. And we should consider the fairness in all the aspects in the university, particularly when you are employing human resources, fairness in income, workplace security, social support, and healthy workplace. And we have started a healthy university initiative to provide healthy atmosphere for the faculty in the university. And we should provide fairness and in all aspects. And it will definitely help to go a long way in protecting the interest of the workforce. Promoting this can have a very long-lasting positive impact, not only the institutional level, also the economic development of the country. I think this is very, very important. All of us, including all the universities, work towards achieving this goal so that we can strengthen our local bodies, we can strengthen our state government. Naturally, it'll have higher, very larger impact on the economic development of the country. Such actions, as I said, should be taken not only at the individual level, it should be in the organization level, and should be at the national level. With this aim, Nitta University has formed various policies in the university. It may be policy on staff welfare, maternity and paternity childcare benefits, policy on gender equity, policy on prevention of gender-based discrimination, policy on access and participation of women, policy on prevention of sexual harassment, protection of complainants, whistleblowers, and witnesses of discrimination harassment. All these policies are in place in this university. I am glad that our officials, our university colleagues, are working towards forming robust framework for implementation of the benefits which should be provided for the employees in the university. Nitta University supports its employees in all aspects. Staff of the university are supported through various welfare measures. We got many welfare measures for the employees, like maybe healthcare benefit, maybe free conveyance to the workplace, subsidized accommodation, fee concession for the children, crush facility in the campus, in the hospital. All these things are provided in the university, particularly in our the flagship of the university, 1,000-bed case a charitable hospital which employs more than 300-350 doctors and more than 800,000 non-teaching faculty in this campus. So I congratulate the KSIDA Charitable Hospital with the Department of this thing, Obstetrics and Gynecology, the Professor Dr. Shipra Sonuskare, who has formed this webinar, and she has invited very distinguished faculty to address the students and the faculty, and our medical superintendent, Major Dr. Shukumar Hiremat, is also participating in this webinar. I think he's one of the very important person in this campus, who is responsible for implementation of policy and doing all the welfare measures of the implementation welfare measures of the employees. And I hope definitely they'll have a very fruitful webinar, and definitely we'll be guided by the very distinguished faculty, Mr. Ramakant Desai and Dr. Sandhya. Definitely they'll help us in further strengthening our all policy and measures to be employed, adopted by the university during these difficult times. I'm very happy to tell you that all of us are going through a very unprecedented situation due to COVID-19 pandemic. Even during this very difficult period, the university has taken strong measures for the welfare of the employees. Organization avoided any layoffs and we paid full salary during the lockdown period and in the whole period of unprecedented difficult time due to COVID-19. And work from home option was also offered to the staff, particularly non-essential services. Employees who contracted COVID-19 are offered free treatment in the hospital. We provide isolation facilities free of cost to all the staff and even to their family members. So we are there for the faculty, and I hope this webinar will have very interesting discussion, and all our employees and teaching and non-teaching staff who are participating in the webinar will be benefited by this webinar. Once again, congratulate Dr. Shipra and Major Dr. Shivakumar for organizing this webinar. Wish you all the best. Once again, thank the distinguished resource persons for participating in this webinar. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much, sir. So thank you for your motivating words and telling us and to work towards attainment of all the SDGs. And as sir has told us, that our university has always shown the care and the concern for all its employees, and even during our tough times. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. Now, I request our Medical Superintendent, Justice KSIDA Charitable Hospital, Major Dr. Shivakumar Hiremat, to welcome the guest and introduce our speakers. Over to you, sir.
Very good morning. It's my pleasure and privilege to welcome and to introduce our resource persons. I would have loved to welcome you all on site rather than off online, but nevertheless, this technology has made us come near and made the world smaller. So this COVID forced norm is the webinars, and it is my, on behalf of NITI DMTB University and Justice KSIDA Charitable Hospital, and on my own behalf, I extend a hearty welcome to our Honorable Vice Chancellor for this webinar, the Sustainable Development Goal Lecture Series, which is the 8th one, that is the Decent Work and Economic Growth. Welcome you, sir. It's my privilege to welcome our distinguished resource persons of the day for this lecture series of today, Professor Ramakant Desai and Professor Sandhya Madam. And I think these two persons are very apt for today's discussion, and it's our privilege to have you online, sir and madam. Welcome you both. I also welcome all the faculty and students of the NITE University and all the institutions, constituent institutions of NITE University who have registered and viewing this program, this workshop online through the NITE tube. Welcome you all, and I am sure that this this workshop will, this lecture series will enlighten us and move us to achieve the sustainable development goals as enshrined by the UN. Now, at the beginning, I would like to introduce one of our guest speakers, the none other than Professor Ramakant Desai, who is the chair of the Association of Chamber of Commerce. And he's a very distinguished management guru, and he has served in various capacities as a vice president, both in the industry as well as the academy. He's currently the chairperson of the Association of Chamber of Commerce, the Healthcare Initiative, and he's also on the advisory panel of the Karnataka BJP Economic Cell. He has been a senior VP of Wipro, and he has managed strategic deals, managed strategic clients. And I'm sure that the vast experience that he has in this business process re-engineering would have a greater impact on us too in by hearing to his lecture. Welcome you, sir.
Now, thank you.
Now, my privilege to welcome Dr. Sandhya Madam, our own Sandhya Madam, who is also one of the resource persons for today. And she has also been a very distinguished management guru. She has been both on the industry as well as the academia. She's a PhD and MBA and a postgraduate in industrial relations, in labor laws, and her specialization in industrial organization and psychology. So again, a very apt person to deliver this lecture on decent work and economic growth, intersection of sustainability and wellness at work. She is she has a lot of industry as well as academic exposure. She has guided PhD scholars. She has co-authored two textbooks. She's working as a reviewer for various journals and a subject matter expert on the panel of various universities, that is Anna University, Bharatiya University, and Christ University, as well as Visveshwara Technology University. So it's my privilege to welcome you, madam, for this program. And I welcome all the other participants who have joined on NITE Tube to this lecture series. Welcome you all.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for the wonderful welcome address as well as introducing our speakers. Now we invite our first speaker without taking more time, Mr. Ramakant Desai, to deliver the first talk. Sir, you can share your screen now.
First of all, good morning to everybody, and thank you, Mr. Vice Chancellor, Mr. Bhandari Garu, Mr. Bhandari Ji, and thank you, Mr. Hiremath, the Superintendent Garu, and thank you, it is nice to get introduced to other panelists, Dr. Sandhya and Dr. Shipra, on the panel. First of all, when I called by NITE school, I initially thought it is NITE, because most of us hear of NITE in our school, in our college days. I'm talking about 1983-84. So that was the first name which struck me. But I was very pleasantly surprised when I went through the university website, NITE University website, that it has got an established medical school. And as the vice chancellor was telling, that it is ranked 100 plus in the sustainable development goals and overall ranking in the world universities as well. And I was also pleasantly surprised that why a medical school is taking up a topic on sustainable development schools. Typically, this is a topic either taken up by the government initiative or for discussion in the government circles or in, say, University of Social Sciences or at best some IIMs. Okay, but I was very, very pleasantly surprised that NITE University wanted to discuss this and understand the implications of this, both for the university and the society at large. That is a very, very welcome thought. And I guess the credit should go to the Vice Chancellor and the coordinators for this initiative for initiating this webinar series on sustainable development goals. As the Vice Chancellor rightly told, these sustainable development goals were initiated by UN, were stated by United Nations and adopted way back in 2015, okay? Essentially, it was a universal call to end the poverty. I think that's a very big statement. To end the poverty globally is a very, very big goal, okay? And ensure that the entire world enjoys peace and prosperity is a very lofty goal. But anyhow, they have stated it and then let us accept it at face value. Now, the one of the distinguishing features of these 17 sustainable development goals is that action in one area will affect the outcome in others because they are all interlinked. It is like no poverty, no hunger, end poverty, okay, human welfare, health, decent work and economic growth. They are not disjoint goals. They are all very, very linked goals. So from that perspective, to ensure that they are socially, economically, and environmentally sustainable is a long-term task. It cannot be achieved in one day. Obviously, a lot of people have to take baby steps and go through the journey to ensure that these become not only the proof of concepts are implemented, but also they can be rolled out as sustainable plans across the across each unit of the society, whether it is a family, whether it is a university, whether it is an institution, whether it is a state government or a local government or a central government, and imagine the complexity across the planet. Okay, essentially, the nations have to commit to prioritize progress for those who have been left behind. This is the essence of the entire SDGs. And obviously the innovation, know-how, technology, you have to take a custom approach, not only at a national level, you have to take a custom approach at even societal level, at each state level, at a municipality level, and things like that. And obviously you need a lot of financial resources to achieve some of these goals. But having said that, let us focus more on the goal 8, which has been talked about, which is the focus of today's discussion, which is essentially decent work and economic growth. I would have ideally worded decent work and inclusive economic growth. Okay, but United Nations has named it as decent work and economic growth. So let us stay with that. Some of the facts and figures, okay, these are all 2015 figures, 2018 figures. So to that extent, there could be some variations as on date, but there is globally 5% unemployment, which is a huge cause for concern. And almost 1 million unemployed people are projected to increase every year. And these are all global figures. 700 million people are living in extreme poverty conditions throughout the globe. That is earning less than, approximately 200 rupees per day. And women's participation in labor force is only 50%. Okay, and it is compared to 75% of men. Whereas overall 2 billion workers are in informal employment. The problem with informal employment is they don't get many of the legally mandated benefits, okay, like healthcare or, PF, et cetera, et cetera. So that is the downside of the, informal employment. And almost 3/4 of the world's wealth is in just hands of 10% population, okay? So if I speak like this, I may sound like a communist, okay? But these are facts of the matter. So first of all, we are all human beings before we are a communist or we are anything else. Now coming to India itself, there is a 500 million labor force. That's almost 50 crores. 10 million is 1 crore. Okay, 500 million is 50 crores. And the average income is much, much less than the national minimum average prescribed by the government of India. they amended it in 2017, which is approximately some 176 rupees a day or whatever it is. Okay. So it is much less than the nationally prescribed minimum average. And then there are almost 1.2 crores enter job market every year. So to provide decent work to almost 1.2 crores is a Herculean task. And more than 20% of the people employed are in hazardous work. So what are the banes of, if we summarize in India situation, the earning capacity of the labor force is still less. Okay, the percentage of women labor force has to increase. And then we have to enable employment for almost 12.8 million people, which is like 1.2 crores every year. And we have to reduce the labor percentage involved in hazardous work. And we also have to reduce the child labor, which is being employed. Okay. Again, these are all we should, are, you know, very good statements to make in web seminars, in seminars, but to kind of address that, on a real plan on the ground is a Herculean task. So let us look through what are some of the, what are some of the issues in India. Now, if you look at India's unemployment rate is approximately 9.3%. I may be giving a lot of statistics and data. It's essentially to impress upon the amount of the seriousness of the problem. Okay, so that is what it is. Okay, sorry, let me just switch off my mobile. It is creating problems. Almost 9.3% is the unemployment rate in India. So if you take the working group as 15 to 60, which is almost 2/3 of India's population, okay, approximately 75-80 crores. And out of which round about 10% is unemployed. That means 7 crores people are either unemployed or underemployed. Okay, national minimum average I already talked about. And I told you that at least 6.2 to 7 crores. These are all published figures. In my view, the numbers will be much larger or paid less than the national minimum average. So the only solution is to encourage entrepreneurship and job creation and achieve full and productivity employment and decent work for all women and men by 2030. Again, it's a should do kind of a statement. But what has government of India done over the last, 20, 25 years? I have taken 15 years as the time frame so that I will not sound politically biased, okay? Which is a very important when you are talking in public seminars, whatever your personal views are. So the thing is, the PM, Jan Dhan Yojana has really accelerated the adoption of or direct transfer of a lot of benefits and hence accumulated almost 25 billion direct benefit transfers through almost 32 crore people. Okay, this one. And also a lot of management of schemes has become a little bit more efficient. I'll tell you why. Because essentially the beneficiaries are being identified directly. And a lot of them have been included through the financial inclusion mechanism of opening of bank accounts, et cetera, et cetera. So let us look at some of the statistics. MNREGA, the scheme started by Mr. Manmohan Singh, has really, and continued by the current government, has really, really provided good rural employment. It's almost 2 billion percentage of employment during 2016-17 alone. And then almost 130 million people covered under pension insurance schemes. And then almost 30 lakh houses are being constructed every year or more than that. And a lot of rural infrastructure is being developed. So if you look at the programs which have been designed, they are integrated. Okay, one is, it is addressing the means of living. It is also addressing the environmental conditions. Environmental conditions in the sense that the sanitation facility has been improved in quite a few rural households. Okay, and a lot of families have been provided with LPG connections. I'm not reading the data because that you can read and I can share the presentation. And also access to clean water has increased almost to 43-45%. That is still very less compared to, because what we need is 100% at least, clean fuel, okay? What we need is at least, 100%. Now, environmental conditions have been addressed. The health conditions have been addressed to a certain extent. The mortality rate has come down. Similarly, health insurance cover has been extended to a lot of people. And there have been a lot of initiatives around literacy and gender equality. 68% are women are literate, and compared to say 55%, say 10, 15 years ago. But these are all the result of various schemes which have been initiated over the last 15 to 18 years. It is not 1 year effort. It's a, or probably 20, 25 years as well. Okay. So 53% of the women are having banking account, but that is still far less. In my view, at least 80% of the women should have it. Okay. And then a lot of maternity benefit programs for the first 6 months. Similarly, a lot of work has been done in the infrastructure space. So infrastructure is being addressed. Literacy and gender equality issues are being addressed. Health conditions are being addressed. And means of living essentially is being addressed, and environmental conditions are being addressed. So a lot of effort is going in by various governments, NGOs, et cetera, et cetera. But what is further needed to be done? Okay, these are all ILO recommendations for India. Okay, this is International Labour Organization. There is still a lot of lack of clarity or lack of transparency in data. So data collection and analysis has to improve, because unless you have access to correct data, you will not implement correct schemes. And more or less, you cannot drive schemes universally from Delhi or say from Bangalore or from Hyderabad or Chennai. You have to customize the programs for local needs. And that is possible only when you start doing a lot of data collection and analysis. And unfortunately, in India, informal economy is large. It's almost, suppose our GDP is $3 trillion. Informal economy is around about 60%. That means actually our economy is around about $4.5 to $5 trillion. Okay, a lot of it doesn't get accounted. And these are all ILO recommendations. So some measures have been taken. Digital payments is going to address to certain extent some of these issues, and we'll also come to GST, et cetera, et cetera. And a lot of promotion of higher skills is being addressed. That essentially new education policy has been drafted. They're trying to focus on a lot of vocational skills, giving diploma certificates after completion of 1 year, things like that. Okay, so which is very good. Okay, and also strengthening of social protection, both through direct benefit transfer and as well as health insurance scheme, et cetera, et cetera. Now, what does it mean? Okay, I will skip this. We'll come back to how was the improvement possible? The improvement was possible basically because of four factors in my view. That is where economic growth comes into picture. For the four factors which enabled rolling out of so many beneficial schemes for a large nation like India has happened because our GDP has grown consistently over 6% over the last 20, 22 years, okay? On an average, okay, CAGR. And the direct tax mobilization has gone up from 8 to 9% to almost 12% plus. It can be more. Even today, the number of taxpayers in the country are very less compared to the size of the country, but at least the direct tax mobilization has gone up. There's an advantage of more of direct tax compared to indirect tax. We'll come to that. That's a debate on tax taxation mechanism. Let's not get into that. Our GST collections have gone up more transparency has come in, essentially because now there is an input linkage and an output linkage. That unless I declare the inputs I am taking, I'll not be able to claim the tax benefits on the output side. So from that perspective, even if one person in the value chain is managing with integrity, the entire value chain can be traced out for tax evasion. So that is the beauty of GST and GSTN, though it has complicated the day-to-day job of various medium and small enterprises and entrepreneurs, but it has streamlined. And this month, the collection has been 1.3 lakh crores, despite the pandemic. That itself is contributed to almost 14, 15 lakh crores. Okay, our direct taxes are around about 8 to 9 lakh crores. Etc. etc. And a lot of leakages got plugged through implementation of technology. Almost in LPG itself, there was a saving of 70,000 crores, DBT, etc., etc. But the entire food subsidies, okay, are approximately 4.2 lakh crores in India. Okay, and the fertilizer subsidy is again the savings here are going to be around 1.3 lakh crores. So essentially, these four factors are driving the buoyancy in treasury. The treasury is getting stronger, and hence governments are able to take a lot of measures which are facilitating both growth as well as inclusion. Okay. Now, what are the challenges? This is the most important thing. Okay. We can always pat on our back, stating that as government has done this, and government can release, you know, advertisement after advertisement. But what needs to be done at a national level is that each of these sectors have to be addressed separately. For example, skills upgradation. I don't think they're still, addressing the basic needs of the society at the level at which they need. Okay, universities are producing good graduates, no doubt about it. But the fact is their skills have to be immediately useful to the industry or workability. Okay, what is the point in a guy doing a BTech and going and employing himself as a call center manager in a call center? It doesn't serve the purpose. Okay, so the thing is, we'll have to see that societal needs have to be met through the skills programs in the universities. So there is a big gap in the academia and society collaboration which needs to be done. And then the biggest thing is the MSMEs, which is essentially micro, small, and medium enterprises. Okay, which includes from the local restaurant to the, say, 150 crore, 300 crore organization or a 500 crore organization. There are approximately 12 to 13 crore such units in India. Okay, they provide, 6 crore units in India. They provide employment to around about 12 to 15 crores. Okay, unfortunately, this sector is under severe stress, especially due to the pandemic or even otherwise. Out of 6 crores, at least 50 lakh units are becoming sick every day. I think there is a priority to, because a lot of people get, especially the people who need jobs and money, get employed in these small organizations. So I think there is a societal need to protect these medium and small organizations. Otherwise, the employability, the employment which is being provided by these guys will be affected. And then the entrepreneurship. Entrepreneurship has to be cross-industry to solve industry problems. It cannot be that I'm a technical guy, I'll come with a better architecture, or I'm a doctor, I'll just become a better doctor. No, you will have to address the societal issue or the industry issue. For example, there is a lot of disparity between the density of doctors in the rural areas versus the density of doctors in the urban areas. There is a lot of disparity between the number of doctors in the south versus the number of doctors available per 10,000 population in the north. So how can we address this healthcare issue using technology and provide healthcare to these people is another problem. I think the entrepreneurship has to move towards that. Say, for example, taking up issues like telehealth, telecare, you know, things like that. I've just taken a healthcare as an example, but similarly, there are a lot of other cross-industry problems to be solved. For example, the cost of logistics in India itself is around about 15%. That means if I'm buying a pen like this, which is costing 25 rupees, 15 to 18% of the cost is logistics. That means from after the finished product, by the time it reaches the end consumer, it is costing that much more. Using technology, can we reduce the cost so that the cost of living can go down? These are all some of the industry problems which have to be solved. I'm spending more time on this slide because this is the most crucial slide. And then the domestic private investment has to pick up. A lot of foreign investment is coming to promote both startups as well as entrepreneurs. But domestic private investment is yet to pick up, though it is much better this year. Almost 7 lakh crores has got invested by the domestic private investment in the last 7 months, but it can do a lot more. For an economy which is around about 180 to 200 lakh crores, our GDP is around about 180 to 200 lakh crores, you know, hardly 7 lakh crores or 10 lakh crores from private investment is peanuts. And that too, almost 70% of the economy being in private hands, 70 to 80%, only 20% is in government hands. And then the startups need to get a lot more leg up. A lot of startups are coming because startups provide employment and also create jobs. For example, today in India, we have got around about 14,000 to 15,000 startups, and 2,500 to 3,000 startups get added every year. I think the entire investment culture has to grow, and that has to take off. And then inclusive credit needs to take off. The credit is available, but 85% of it goes to large corporates. It doesn't go to small and medium corporates. For example, if I take just last 12 months, 23 lakh crores credit has gone to large industries. Only 1.5 lakh crores has gone to medium and small industries. That though it has grown by 54%, but if you look at the ratio, 25 crores versus 1.5 lakh crores, it is, you know, huge difference. Whereas 85% of the labor force is in MSMEs. Okay, so I think we'll have to find that balance.
Sorry to interrupt you, sir. Can you please shorten the talk? Because we have another speaker and we are positive of time.
Okay. I couldn't hear you. I know I only heard one thing, that we have to finish fast because of the paucity of time. I'll do it. Yeah. I'll just address, it's almost last but one slide. Thank you. And then equitable access to education and healthcare is must. Migrant labor is a big issue. I think the government will have to undertake on priority basis, low cost housing in urban areas, because urban areas provide 50% of the employment. Top 10, 15 cities contribute to 50% of India's GDP. Okay, and the child labor, wages, safety, you know, women labor, you know, safety, sanitation, these are all some of the issues to be addressed. So to achieve goals, you know, what we need to SDG goals, over next 5 years, we need at least $1.5 trillion. There is a huge gap, okay, in what we can mobilize versus what needs to be achieved. It's a big problem to be solved. It cannot be solved in a simple webinar like this. We need to take it up on a priority basis. I think the entire society will have to step up. Okay, I know I gave a lot of data. With this, I would like to conclude and ask other panelists to reflect on some of these issues and their thoughts. Thanks a lot. To the Vice Chancellor and all the coordinators for inviting me for this discussion. Thanks a lot.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for the wonderful lecture and telling us how India is already on the way to achieve this goal and how important it is for our country and how serious it is for us to make sure that we are on the way to achieve this goal. Thank you so much, sir. Now, without taking much time, I would like to invite Dr. Sandhya, highly qualified professional with all the degrees you name it, and still pursuing her executive program in advanced leadership in the digital world from IIM Lucknow. Madam, we are really waiting just to hear from you. Over to you, madam.
Thank you, ma'am. Good morning, everyone. First, I would like to thank Vice Chancellor Dr. Bhandari, sir, Dr. Satish Kumar Hiremath, sir, Dr. Shipra Andi for having given a very sweet introduction. And I congratulate the management for taking the initiative of organizing the Sustainable Development Goal Lecture Series. And I extend my thanks for inviting me as the resource person. I welcome all the participants for today's session on this. I will share the screen so that we can start with this. As just now we have heard from Dr. Ramakant's Desai sir, the facts and figures. Now the focus is to move from economic growth to sustainable development. When we look at the world is characterized by both developed and developing countries. Regardless of which end of the spectrum a nation stands, both extremes have caused stress in the world. Therefore, it is important to understand the differences, issues between the developed and developing nations, and to effectively understand the dynamics, the constraints which are characterized by the pressures of population growth, the inefficient technology, the poor health sector, the low per capita income, and poverty. Therefore, the emphasis for developing countries greatly relay on the need for progress, a desire to have social and economic growth. In terms of those perspectives from the developing countries, economic growth results in increasing wealth, income, standard of living, and improved healthcare facilities. When we think in terms of economic growth, we realize that growth is the major economic goal of many nations. Thus, as a goal, a nation that can achieve economic growth will be better suited to meet the wants of the individuals and to resolve the socio-economic problems such as poverty. However, for every problem, there is a solution. The international community has realized the need for a strategic, comprehensive approach to address these issues, while at the same time to foster the development. The sustainable and inclusive economic growth is a prerequisite for sustainable development. The World Congress of Environment and Development has defined the sustainability as the need which helps to understand the present without compromising the ability of future generations to meet their own needs. So the entire aspect of sustainable development is considered as an integrated approach which requires meeting the basic needs towards the aspiration for a better, improved quality life based on democracy, where the rule of law is grounded in the respect of fundamental rights, and also which promotes the employment in an economy whose strength is based on education, innovation, social cohesion, and the protection of human health and environment. Keeping the time in constraint, I'll just move across few slides. So according to the ILO, as we have seen the facts and figures, 5.6% of the global population are unemployed. The total number of unemployed people remains high, somewhere around 192 million, and 470 million jobs are needed globally for new entrants to the labor market by 2030. In addition to creating jobs, nations also need to improve conditions for somewhere around 783 million women and men who are working but not earning enough to lift themselves and their families out of poverty. Thus, the ILO agenda provides a roadmap for economic growth and sustainability. In the face of multiple systematic interconnected crises, the solutions requires all of us to play our part. These are 17 indicators for sustainable economic growth as proposed by ILO. No poverty, zero hunger, good health and well-being, quality education, gender equality, clean water and sanitization, affordable and clean energy, decent work and economic growth, industry, innovation and infrastructure, reduced inequalities, sustainable cities and communities, responsible consumption of production, climate action, life below water, life on land, peace, justice and strong institutions, and partnerships for the goals. Particularly, Goal 8 of the SDGs, which focus on to promote inclusive and sustainable economic growth, employment, and decent work for all, represents a crucial departure from the idea that safeguarding employees and their well-being in the work environment in some ways acts as an economic ball and chains of business at the both national and global development. Therefore, there shall be a strong link between the goals and a balancing approach in the global strategy for sustainable development. So SDG promotes sustained, inclusive and sustainable economic growth, full and productive employment and decent work for all. When we try to understand the concepts of decent work, it is productive work for women and men in conditions of freedom, equity, security and human dignity. So in general, a work is considered a decent work when it pays a fair income and it guarantees a secure form of employment and safe working conditions. So productive employment and decent work are the key elements in achieving a fair globalization and poverty reduction. Decent work thus involves opportunities for work that is productive and delivers a fair income, security in the workplace and social protection for families, better prospects for personal development and social integration, freedom for people to express their concerns, organize and participate in the decisions that affect their lives, and equity of opportunity and treatment for all men and women. So when we look at the measurement framework on decent work, What works to achieve the sustained economic growth, productivity, and job satisfaction or job creation? Employment opportunities, adequate earning and productive work, decent working time, combining work, family, and personal life, work that should be abolished, stability and security of work, equal opportunity and treatment in employment, safe work environment, social security, social dialogue, employees and workers' representatives are few of the measurements of decent work. When we try to understand and learn about the 12 targets of Goal 8, it rests upon understanding the sustainable economic growth, understanding the diversity, innovative, and upgrade economic productivity, promote policies to support job creation and growing enterprises, improve resource efficiency in consumption and production, full employment and decent work with equal pay, employment, youth employment, end modern slavery, trafficking, and child labor, protect labor rights and promote safe working environments, promoting beneficial and sustainable tourism, universal access to banking, insurance, and financial services, increase aid for trade support, and develop a global youth employment strategy. In the face of the multiple systematic interconnection crises, the solution requires all of us to play our part. The global goals cannot be achieved without business. Through their core operations, financial commitments, employee networks, consumer-facing platforms, and high-level influence, the organizations and the business have a crucial role to play in accelerating progress towards the goal. Every business and every employee can make a vital contribution to creating a more peaceful, equitable, and profitable future. Whether we work to live or live to work, we cannot escape the fact that we spend a significant portion of our life within the work environment. Moreover, our experiences and remuneration within the work are crucial to shaping our family relationships and own emotional and physical health outside the work. However, not all jobs are equally valuable in the role they play in individual quality of life. So in order to meaningfully understand the effects of employment on individual well-being, we must collect systematic information on the quality of working life, failing to do which poses a risk to business, government, and society at large. So when we look at the priorities for action, wellness at workplace becomes the highest priority. So however, in the recent times, due to the pandemic, which has been an unprecedented event, disturbing our way of life and has caused increased stress and anxiety for workers everywhere. Pandemic has brought the importance of health, both physical and mental, to the center stage of the business agenda. It has exacerbated the employees' feelings of anxieties, fears, and depression, brought mental health issues to the fore, and highlighted the insufficiency of our present assistance programs to the benefit programs. Thus, the business has to focus on a variety of resources to help the employees cope up with returning to the work during these difficult times. So the organizations focus on bringing the wellness to the business, where wellness is the interactive process of becoming aware of and making choices, and particularly participating healthy choices to create more healthy, successful, fulfilling, and balanced life. So why organizations must prioritize wellness in the workplace? So developing and adopting a framework that is grounded in compassion, holistic wellness, meaningful interactions, and flexibility helps the organizations and business to create a workplace culture driven by empathy and focused on holistic employee well-being. It helps the business to gain a competitive advantage and explore creative solutions to support the workforce effectively. So how are the organizations and business prioritizing employee well-being? So the strategy of reset and recharge policy helps the business to bring the well-being of employees at the workplace. So the business can focus on creating and extending support in terms of conducting webinars with health tech experts, where the companies can continue to conduct knowledge sharing webinars for employees with doctors, health experts, and nutritionists for sessions on various foods which help them to boost immunity, cardiorespiratory health, etc. And the employees can have an additional time off, like paid no asked vacation, time off policies, then which helps the employees to recuperate from elevated level of stress and anxiety, for self-care, and to allow them to spend certain time with family and friends. The organizations and the business can also extend financial assistance to the employees, where they can help the employees, treating employees and their families, including self-testing, self-home care, assisted home care, quarantine packages of hospitals, emergency medical care, salary advance, emergency assistance grants, etc. The organizations can also prioritize employee well-being and mental health by providing 24/7 counseling helplines, access to self-improvement or meditation, mental well-being apps, unlimited sick leave policies, regular reach outs to the top management, sick and mental health leave, no question asked, unlimited sick leave policy, or to have access to fun where they can release their anxiety and stress through various fun activities like individual and science-based activities and games to reduce stress, deal with anxiety, and improve resilience. So these help the organizations, both for employees and employers. So these are a few of the aspects which the business can consider in order to bring the well-being and wellness in the workplace. Thank you.
Thank you, madam. Thank you really so much for educating us and elaborating on the different components of the recent work and focusing on wellness at the workplace. I should really say that we are privileged, we are very happy and privileged to say that we actually enjoy most of the benefits which are meant for decent work for the employees. I really feel privileged to say that. And now, the webinar was live streamed, and it will be available on the YouTube. The comments can be seen there, and the quiz also will be there on the YouTube. Now we come to the end of the webinar, and I really thank our beloved Vice Chancellor, who has agreed to provide his valuable opening remarks from his busy schedule and stayed throughout during this webinar. I thank our resource persons, Mr. Ramakant Desai and Dr. Sandhya, who took their time out for enlightening us on this sustainable development goal. I thank our medical superintendent, Major Dr. Shivakumar Hiremath, for welcoming our guest speakers and introducing them. I sincerely thank our very active and proactive and always motivating University SDG coordinator, Dr. Smita Hegde, for her constant support, for her concern, and the continuous help given to me. I thank Madam Sadhana Deshmukh and Ms. Supriya for help and support for organizing this webinar right from the beginning. I thank Dr. Harsha, our curriculum director at Nitya University, our web coordinator for IT support and its live streaming. I thank all the participants who are watching this at present on YouTube and will be watching this on YouTube. Thank you all. Thank you so much. Now we can log out of this webinar. Thank you all. Log off this webinar.
Hello.
Yes, sir. Sir, can you please? Yes, sir.
Yeah. I thank the distinguished speakers for enlightening us both perspective, or the national perspective as well as the institutional level, what we can do. I think it was wonderful talk by both the participants. I would like to say that we have started a wellness center in the university. The last year, we started a wellness center in the university to look after the welfare of the faculty as well as the students. I think particularly the talk by Dr. Sandhya can be taken as one of the guideline for implementation, certain aspects which have not been implemented in the university. I request the coordinators of this webinar to take the positive points from both the talks, because certain aspects are beyond our control. I agree with the Professor Desai that most of the things are beyond our reach, because that has got long-term implications, particularly economic contribution by these tax payers, public, as well as by the revenue generated by the government, both state and central government. But certain aspects of this particular welfare of the faculty and students can be definitely taken up by the university. What are the measures to be done? I want some white paper on this. What are the particular very important SDG as far as the university is concerned. I request the coordinators of this, particularly Shipra and Major Shivakumar Hiramat, definitely give some summary of what we have discussed today.
Sure, we'll do that, sir. You can log out now, sir.
Okay.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, madam.